since Joyce went to noon. And that's point blank. I have no other words other than to say, ladies and gentlemen, James Crystal Radio, WFTL, 850 AM, Joyce Kaufman.
Who is that? Who's he talking about? What an honor to be in a multiple rooms full of American patriots who didn't think it was robbery to come out on a Thursday night when they could have been doing anything else, but instead decided that their country was worth coming out for. Plus the wings, come on. You know. Let's face it, you know, Brian does provide a very nice menu here, and that encourages large turnouts. But it's not about, you know, who we are when we sit in here together. It's about who we are when we walk out of here at the end of these meetings or at the end of these events or at the end of these fundraisers. And I was struck today, well, I've been struck for the last 24 hours, for those of you who are listeners. It's been an incredible journey, and it really has made me conscious of how powerful you are. You know, when I went on the air yesterday and said Publix has a calendar out that has December 7th listed as Islamic New Year and not Pearl Harbor Day, you guys shut them down. In 3 hours, I had an apology from Publix, and all those calendars had been removed. Now, I like to fancy that I'm a highly popular radio personality, and I could pull off just about anything, but I didn't expect to do that in 3 hours, and I certainly didn't expect to be so blessed a couple of months ago when my boss was thinking about bringing on another radio personality and asking me to take on the big guy at noon, which is something that most people, when they're presented at my stage in my career, for somebody to say, we want to put you on opposite Rush, you might as well say, we want to shoot you in the head. And I prayed about it, and I decided that the difference today from ever before in radio, and I've been doing this a long time, is that it's true, all politics are local. And everybody needs to have somebody in their community who's talking about the things that are happening in their lives, who is able to bring that national story, whether it's health care or whether it's cap and trade or whether it's illegal immigration, home to your block, to your city commission, and in our case, the most corrupt county commission in the entire country. How about that, Broward? We're number one. But it's all local. Politics is all local. And it really, when I thought about that and when that was revealed to me in my meditation and my prayer, I said, you know what? I'm not really taking on Rush. I'm providing an alternative. If you want to know what's happening in your community, how national politics affect you, well, then you're at least going to tune into my show for part of the day. If you want to hear from candidates like Ed Lynch or you want to hear from candidates like Alan West, you're going to have to put on my radio program, although now some of these guys get a little national exposure. I understand the first place that Robert Lowry or anybody else came to announce was my show, because I am the local anchor, and I'm very grateful, because without you guys it wouldn't matter one bit. Because if I can't see numbers like this and they don't start showing up in ratings books, doesn't matter how good a job I do, I won't last very long, and I certainly won't be able to earn a living. So I'm ever so grateful, but I'm ever so empowered by what happened in the last 24 hours, and it leads me to the message about what needs to happen now. Because it's very interesting, you know, I struggled without a colleague for a long time, and then they brought in a colleague for a while who apparently thought I was the worst thing that had ever happened to radio. And he would spend this entire program berating me for hours, and it was a miserable year for me, Jim Defeaty. But when he left, when he was forced out, basically, and they waited 6 months and came to me and said, we want to get somebody on the air, I said, no. I said, don't do that to me. If you're going to get anybody, you have to let me pick. And much to my surprise, they did. And I was able to get what I now call JK squared, Joyce Kaufman and Jeff Katz, back to back for 6 hours a day. And he is as committed as I am to bringing this home, to bringing home the elections, to bringing our community to the forefront, to being the place that the rest of the country looks to. Think about this for a moment. The two hottest races, and, you know, cover your ears, the guys who are not in these two of the hottest races, but the two hottest races in the country right now are Rubio Crist and Alan West versus Ron Klein. It is what it is. The whole country is looking at these candidates, and we're in the eye of the storm. And we get to make a statement about how the people of Florida said, no, you're not going to put a candidate in without a primary in the case of the senatorial race. We're not going to tolerate that. We'll fight back. We have three candidates, Senator Bob Smith, Speaker of the House Marco Rubio, and Governor Charlie Crist. And we're going to let it play out in the state of Florida. We did that. They thought they were just going to ramrod the governor into this election, and it was the people who said, no, it's not going down that way. It's not that we don't love Governor Crist. Okay, so it is that we don't love Governor Crist. But that wasn't the primary motive at the beginning, certainly not for me, because anybody here, particularly the Rubio, you know, diehards, will tell you that the last person I wanted to support was Marco Rubio, okay? Because he stood in the way of state house immigration bills, which mattered to me and to this community. There are people in this room right now, there's a person sitting at a table over there, who fought and went to Tallahassee and was promised by Marco Rubio that those bills would pass, and in the end, they got stopped. So I was not, you know, it wasn't like I was a big Rubio supporter, let's put it that way. But I did not like the fact that the party had decided who your candidate was. I'm not a Republican. So the Republican Party had made a decision not based on the will of the people, and it was gratifying to see the people say, not so fast. Not so fast. And that's your mission. Not so fast to any of this. We're not caught up. And let me tell you something else that, you know, that really I've learned a lot. Wayne shot that incredible video that went viral, the revolution video that went viral. But, you know, when I look at that video, and most of you have seen it, and many of you have seen the list of comments that comes on after it, and the way the whole country has suddenly discovered something that we have treasured for so long in Colonel Alan West, I thought, though, you know what they don't get? They don't get the difference between a warrior and a politician still around the country. See, we do. I don't have to write a comment, oh, this guy should be president. I want a warrior to go to Congress. That's where the power is. That's the purse strings of this country. If they don't cut the check, nothing happens. The president can sit there and look pretty. He can be as, sign as many executive orders as he wants, which is obviously something this guy's very comfortable doing. But in the final analysis, if Congress doesn't cut the check, nothing happens, all right? So you don't send your warriors to the White House. You send your warriors to the House of Representatives. And we get that here in Florida. And tonight we hear about another warrior that you're going to send. And that's what I want you to stay focused on, is that we have a different message than has been going out around the country. And we are finally getting attention. For the first time, we're not hanging chads. We're not going into little kids' bedrooms with machine guns and rousting them out and putting them on airplanes to Cuba. That's not how they're seeing Florida right now. Instead, they're seeing this very politically astute, this very politically involved populace who has stepped out of the shadows and said, not on our watch, not in our country. And that's what we have to leave these meetings with. It's all fine and dandy, and I apologize. I can't get to every meeting. I mean, my heart is with almost every group at every meeting that takes place. But if I were to try and go to every meeting that I'm invited, as it is, I'm out 5 nights a week, and it's a lot. It's a lot for my family, and it's a lot for me. But I have to tell you, I need to know that when you gather like this, it's not just about feeling good for an hour or two and being with like-minded citizens, but that you leave armed with something that you can go into your community with and do differently, some conversation that you can get involved in. You know, one of the things that happened with this whole Publix fiasco was it gave everybody a chance to turn to this World War II vet that they've lived near for their entire life and say, did you see Publix didn't put Pearl Harbor down. What? And a conversation starts. You know, half of the people you're going to be talking to are yellow dog liberal Democrats who've never voted for, you know, anybody but a Democrat in their entire life. And now you struck up a conversation based on something we both agree on. Vets were dishonored by that calendar. The door is open. Now what do you do? You better be prepared to have a logical case to present that changes the way they think about this upcoming election. 2010, whether you're talking about the special election, whether you're talking about the congressional and senatorial elections that'll take place in November, whatever, if you're not prepared to make a compelling argument for a candidate, well, then you know what? Don't even bother with the opening comment, because you end up embarrassing those of us who are armed. And I'm all about getting information. You have this incredible internet available to you and each other. How much time do you spend accumulating information? You know, Wayne is a genius with the camera. And last Wednesday, we had a rally on the corner of 3rd and Broward where we were supporting Israel. And much to my chagrin, I thought 2,000 or 3,000 people would turn up. Well, we didn't get 2,000 or 3,000 people. We got a good crowd, a couple of hundred people. But he took a video of the speeches that were delivered that day. There's not a person in this room who shouldn't watch those videos. They should see every single one of those videos, because information was shared by Joe Kaufman, by Bob Kunst, by Tom Trento, by Alan West, by Robert Lowry, by all of the various people that were there. They all said something that arms you to engage in a discussion as to why America needs to support the only democracy in the Middle East, okay? If you don't know that, and if you're just doggone lazy, which I doubt, watch at least my video where I say there are 7 reasons to support Israel. Take them down. Put them, burn them into your memory, and go out there and deliver that message, because this battle has to be fought on many, many different levels. Everybody you talk to, you can engage in another area. You don't have to always talk about congressional. You don't have to talk about fiscal responsibility. You don't have to talk about health care. You'll know what that one issue is that opens that door to that one person, that one other community member that you can then encourage to come to the next meeting, because that's how this is going to happen. I believe that the reason Publix had to respond to me in 3 hours was because they saw the clock ticking. And when 200 people walked into Boynton Beach stores, and 180 people walked into the Margate Coconut Creek stores, and 250 people walked into the Fort Lauderdale store, and 85 people walked into the Lighthouse Point store, they said, you know what? There's a lot of people upset. And that's how numbers matter. We've got to be able to take the group that we have here and double, triple, quintuple, sextuple, 100 times as many people, and get them out invisible. Because in union, there is strength, and I don't mean the SEIU, all right? We have got to be a unified front. We have got to educate ourselves about these candidates. It is not enough to put a sticker on your shirt. It's not enough to put a baseball cap on and say, I support Ed Lynch, or I support another candidate. You have to, at some point, decide to become an advocate for that candidate. You have to be able to go and be their surrogate in a conversation. Whoever your candidate is, I'm not the person to sit here and tell you that it has to be so-and-so, or although I will tell you, it has to be Alan West. It has to be Alan West, okay? I'm not at all abashed about saying it has to be Alan West, okay? It has to be a lot of guys, but it has to be only because he will empower everybody to do what they want to do. He has a commander's heart, and we need a commander. We've got great troops, but without a commander, we're going to end up in the same condition that we've always been in, okay? So that's the reason I say it does have to be him. But I really, if there's other candidates that you have a passion for, don't just stick the sticker on your car. I mean, that does not help that candidate get elected. You have to become that candidate surrogate. I had a young man on my show who's seated here today. He said, what are you, 13? 14, okay, excuse me. I mean, he's like, you know, Connor Lansing came on my show, and he made the most, he made a better case for Ed Lynch than Ed has ever made on my show. And I'm not taking a shot at Ed. I'm just telling you that when someone can articulate why they support a candidate, it's very compelling. when they personalize it and say, this is what he represents to me, it's very compelling. And each one of us are those kinds of advocates. We're the surrogate for whoever it is that you support. You've got to support them with your heart, with your soul, and with your treasure. And that's the part where everybody gets upset with me. And I know that. But I'm one of those people who understands that these election procedures have now become, campaigns have become enormously expensive. To be competitive in a congressional campaign is a mind-boggling figure. I was looking at a budget today of a person who's in a very good position to win a congressional race, not here locally, but in another state. And the incumbent, the Democrat incumbent, has $17 million in the bank. Okay, so the challenger is hoping that he can raise $5 million so he could be somewhat competitive in this race. Now, $5 million is a lot of money, okay? And it's going to take a lot of his constituents and people around the country. They're actually trying to take the seat that Ted Kennedy vacated and get it into the hands of a Republican. So they've gone out to try and solicit money from all over the country quite successfully. $5 here, $10 here, $20 here. How good would it make you feel if the seat in Massachusetts went to a Republican? Or an independent. Just anybody but, you know, anybody but another Democrat in Massachusetts. It just would absolutely send a powerful message. But you see, how's he going to do that when the person who's running, not even an incumbent, he's basically, you know, the heir to the throne, has that much money already? How do you run against, for instance, a Ron Klein? Now we got Wexler out of the picture. But don't you believe for a second that they're going to consider someone who doesn't bring a lot of money to the table. That's why, you know, Ted was anointed so quickly, because he has the capital. You look at these races, you say you support Ed, you say you support Joe, you say you support Robert, you say you support Alan. If you haven't put a dime into their campaigns, take your stickers off, take them off your car, because you annoy me. You really do. It doesn't work like that. It just doesn't. You don't have to give, $2,400, but you got to put your money where your mouth is. You got to give them $10. You got to give them $20. You got to give them $50. You got to make it your business to get somebody else to give them some money, because otherwise, it's like sending a gladiator into the arena where he's facing a guy who's got the chain with the ball and chain and the whips, and you give him a pea shooter and you say, hey, could you go fight Goliath? Doesn't work like that. You've got to at least give him a weapon to fight with. And in this market, and these guys who are in this room today will verify this, the problem with Broward Palm Beach markets is you got to buy Dade and Broward TV time. It is the third most expensive market in the country. Okay, you can't get away with, you know, there's guys running in Columbus and you know, they're like, well, I got $1 million, I'll be fine. Sure, you can run on Columbus television 24 hours a day with $1 million. You're going to get about 10 minutes worth of spots in Miami-Dade, you know, and that's, but I tell you that because sometimes the candidates fail to tell you that. They encourage you, they don't want to sound like they're begging and all the rest of it, but I don't care, I'm shameless, you know. They can't win if we don't give them what they need to win. No matter how much we love them, no matter how right they are, no matter how wrong the opposition is, at some point, you've got to be willing to just pony up. And I'm not embarrassed to say that. I am, I believe in tithing, and I also believe that my country deserves my tithes. It's not just my religious affiliation where I tithe 10%. I tithe 10 to 15% to candidates every single year, because if I can help somebody get elected who's actually going to do something for my country, it's money well spent, well invested. You know, I don't need yet another toy. I have an iPhone. That's sufficient. I really need nothing else. You know, I don't even need a computer anymore because I have my iPhone. So, you know, there's a limit to how much stuff we've all accumulated and how little we've contributed. That's got to stop. That's got to stop. And I know the candidates are the only ones in the room right now who are going, yes, Joyce, go, Joyce, keep it up, Joyce. But you guys have to understand, you know, that's who I am. I tell you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, as bad as it may feel sometimes to hear the truth. And here's the other part of the truth that I wanted to say today, and then I'll move aside and let somebody else speak. There is an atmosphere In my district, I live in Congressional District 19. For years, I have had to sit there in a community that wears Robert Wexler t-shirts, okay? And I would come in with my Dump Wexler t-shirts and all of these things, and they would be all upset with me, but I didn't really care. It was a hostile community, but I hung in there, you know? And I suffered through misrepresentation, lack of representation. It was unbelievable to me that I lived in a community where it was proven that my congressman didn't even live in the state of Florida and nobody cared. You know, I was grieved by that personally. I couldn't get my congressman to come on my show. I was the only radio host in America who lived in his district, and it was the only show in America that he didn't go on. And we had that countdown clock, you know, 750 days of asking him every day to come on my show and him not doing that. That's a pretty horrible position to have been in. Well, it was actually kind of fun, but it tells you how I feel about my life in CD19. So imagine, for the first time in the last election, a little energy came into my district, and all of a sudden there was somebody willing to, like, fight, to walk into my community and fight back. And I thought, wow, you know, this is kind of amazing. I'd never seen anything. Like, Ed would show up at the Democratic clubs and, you know, get booed and kicked aside, and he was like, okay, I'm walking in Winmore. And I'm thinking, this is great, you know, something's happening, okay? And it was the first time. Tell you how powerful this is, okay? There had never been a Republican club in Winmore before. There were a couple of guys who every now and then would sit in the back and, you know, they would, kind of whisper and stuff. All of a sudden, there's a Republican club listed in the newspaper there alongside of the Ceramics and the Democrats and the Sisterhood and all the other stuff. All of a sudden, and little by slowly, those same people that came up to me in the gym would engage in a conversation with me about a candidate who dared to run against Robert Wexler. And it was an opening for me to have this kind of communication. So I was very excited. But what has happened in my district now is it is not always so pleasant anymore. It is not, the special election has thrown a monkey wrench into this. And I'm one of these people who tell it like I see it. You know, if Robert Wexler, I believe this was calculated on the part of the Democratic Party. I believe that they knew exactly what they were doing. I believe that they thought that for the first time there was a possibility that seat was in trouble, because not only was Wexler in trouble, but there was somebody willing to fight for it. And they said, you know what? Before the crap hits the fan, we need you to take this million-dollar job at a think tank that's been defunct for the last couple of years. How about that? You know, and that move was made, but it really hurt. It really hurt us. It really hurt opposition, because it is never a good position to be in, to have to recapture not only yourself at this special election moment, and these now we have three guys in a primary, okay? It's not even just like a special election. We've got a special primary and a special election, and the dilution is powerful. To overcome that, you're going to have to work twice as hard. That's all there is to it. Because at the end of the day, whether or not the Republican candidate wins the special election, you're a couple of months away from another election. And it's a very important election, a time during which people who might have only had a slim chance before are going to have an elevated chance. They're going to be riding a wave. And you need to make sure that no matter what happens, don't be demoralized, because the opportunity in November, on November 3rd, 2010, is still the best chance. My congressional district, and I say this, you know, not because I'm predicting anything negative, but just in case, 2010 is right around the corner. Stay focused, because that's the year where you're going to see, in spite of Michael Steele, in spite of John Boehner, you're still going to see an enormous upswell of grassroots activists around the country, many of who aren't Republicans, but have been forced to seek out Republican candidates in retaliation for the misery that's being inflicted upon them by the majority party at this point. They are going to have a very large wave, and that wave lifts all boats. okay? And we need to remember that. And not to get overly melodramatic about this, the turn of events that ended us up in a special election, because I see that people have really forgotten that even, doesn't matter, if Ed Lynch wins and goes to Congress, he's got to come back and face somebody in November. That's just the bottom line. And to lose that focus, the most important election of my lifetime is 2010, more important than 93-94, more important than 68. And I mean, this is it. Because if something doesn't change after the census and amnesty, we won't be meeting like this in the Wings Plus anymore, okay? Game over. Game over, and like Jack Moss, the former commissioner who was on my show today, said, I'm moving to Ecuador. You know, game over. So this is big stuff. This is important time. That's why when Mr. Gleason and Karen Hoffman and all the various groups put out the alarm, we came, because we're scared to death. And when people are scared, sometimes they make mistakes. No matter how scared we are, we can afford no mistakes, because this is an enemy that capitalizes on your weakness and on your mistakes. That, you know, that photograph that's issuing now, since you guys were all originally from a meetup group, you know, that photograph of the President Hussein teaching a class on Saul Alinsky's model is a very powerful message to you. He understands that model. He has implemented the first stages of that graph, and he is well on his way to implementing the entire graph. And if we don't get in his way, chaos, food riots, an entitlement class that controls and dominates the production class in this country, and it's really game over. Just is. There'll be no political process that you recognize. There will be an ample opportunity for these evil, and I'm not afraid to say it, these evil people to stop the next election after that. 2012, there will not be an election if we don't stop the madness in 2010. I'm not a conspiratorialist. I'm just a realist. I've been following this for a long time. There's nothing I like better than dismantling and dismembering political action. So please, whatever you do today, if you make a commitment tonight that you're going to support a candidate, you got to do it. If you learn something tonight, you have to take it out and tell somebody else. You have to tell people, and this is where I get real self-serving, you have to leave here today and say, you got to listen to this woman on the radio. Because in the process of listening to me, they hear you. And in the process of hearing you, they get courage. We have to give them the courage. They want to be here with us tonight. They're just more afraid than they are. When the pain of staying the same gets greater than the pain of change, they'll change. Thank you, and keep up the good work.